Hello and welcome to my first English video for Starbase. My name is Softwerker and I'm usually doing modern Minecraft or some sandbox, technical sandbox games. But ever since start of the Starbase Alpha, since I'm in the Alpha, I'm having a blast here. The game is just simply amazing and I'm loving it. I'm currently doing a German Let's Play series about it. And also do streams or occasionally. In one of my last videos, I presented this ship behind me, the Truchenik. I'm not sure if I'm speaking it correctly. I call her Trudy. I like it. And I presented this ship that I bought from Rando Free for about 56 million credits. And in my video, I already presented it as possibly the best mining ship that you can have in Starbase. And I was approached asking for an English version of the game because some people agreed and they would like to see more, but let's face it, the automatic captioning from YouTube is not the best way to go through it. So, and also I have done some more changes to it. I've done some more updates that have now made it for sure the best mining ship in the game. Just to give an example. With this ship right now, I can fly from my station about 25 kilometers into the mining belt, mine there until all 256 ore crates are full, and fly back. And I timed it within 32 minutes. And I haven't seen a single ship who can carry that much ore, be still as fast flying, and have such an amazing way of mining the asteroids in a combination package. I believe this might be really the really best ship that you can have. I would have designed my own ship. I was thinking of designing my own mining ship, but I don't think I have to do it anymore because this one, that's the one. I tell you, this is the best mining ship that you can have in the current meta. I was also approached by the ship's designer or by the faction of the designer asking for some feedback because there were some bugs that I had to fix, and I'm gonna go on that talk about that in more details in a few seconds. So there is a high chance that a few things, or maybe all of them, possibly all of them, are outdated by the time that you are watching this video. That means the ship's designer have incorporated my changes, my feedback, and have made the ship as good as it could be. But let's not dwell too long in the beginning. I hate too long intros, but since you don't know me in the English community, I decided to give it a little bit of flavor. I have separated the whole process in three segments. The first segment will be some bug fixing that you need to do in order to make the ship working properly. It is working, but there are some flaws. The second part will be some minor adjustments that you can do, just some value changes that will help you improving the ship's capabilities already. And then lastly, there will be some major adjustments, which is mostly including some changes to some YOLO scripts, adding new buttons or something like this, so you can really get the best out of the ship. So, into the bug fixing. What you need to do for the bug fixing are three things. The first thing, that's a very simple fix, is the ore collector. The ore collector on itself, when you get it, has one problem. It is too weak. It doesn't collect all the ores as fast as it could be. And that's a simple mistake done by the ship developer. Or let's say it's a mistake from the developers of the game that has been implemented then by the design of the ship, because the ore collector itself has a key that is called power. So whenever you call something power in your system where the ore collectors are connected, it will adjust this value. The design of the ship have called the generator unit rate, so how much power the generator generates, power to display it in our in one of the bars, so we can see how much power the generator is generating. However, every change there would then set the power of the ore collector. And since the limit is 100, The ore collector would always collect between 0 and 100, which is really not much. So first, the first thing you need to do is, so you, the easiest way to do is simply to rename this device field. I called it collector power in this case, and then give it a manual value. I started off with 400, but since I implemented, it was enough, but with the new changes, I would recommend to go at least 800 or higher. The maximum here would be 2000. The higher you go, the higher the power consumption, but other than, there's no other drawback. But I figured that 800 is actually working pretty fine for me. If it's not enough, just increase it a little bit. And make sure to do it for both ore collectors. That's the first fix. Easy, simple one, no problem. Just go there and change the name to collector power, whatever you want to, and then give it a value of 800 or more. The second change is also an oversight by the ship developer, which is that this tank here is not connected to the system. So you only draw propellant from the last two. Overall, you would have 36 million of propellant available, but you can only fly with 48, which is, of course, a waste. So grab some cables, grab a pipe from wherever you can find it, and then connect it to the bottom or the top. We found it the easiest after quite a bit of experimenting. The easiest way we found was to rip off those two batteries here. And then right under it is the connector for the tank. So rip off those one or two batteries here, put them aside. There's no, there, only those cables are connected, so you can easily reconnect them afterwards. There's nothing in the back, so no problem there. And then connect the tank with the pipe and with the cable, and then it should be working fine for you. Also, in combination with that, there's a display here called propellant. And here it's over there, which tells you how much fuel you have. You might realize that your the sign right now for you only says 12 million. That was another problem, another mistake by the ship developer, because they looked at the tank and gave this field, the gas container stored with source, the naming propellant. So you would see the propellant of one tank only. Since the system takes from all tanks equally, it's fine, but the bar would be correct, but the number would be incorrect. However, if you have built some ships, you know that if you look at the tank support, there is a value field that's called gas network stored resources, which calculates all the propellant in all connected containers. In this case, it says it's 21 million. Also, it says how much there is. So you can take those values now and rename this field to propellant while renaming this field to something else, or just give it the original value back. And then this display will show the exact number of propellant that you have in a system and that is currently used up. A bit more difficult bug fix, but a worthy one, and that was step number two. Step number three is now even more difficult, but also very important. If you fly with the Trudy, you will see that your power value up here rarely ever reaches 100. Regardless if the battery is empty or not, and when you fly, that's the most important part. When you fly, you notice that the battery will drain, and then your ship will become unstable flying, because there's not enough power in the batteries to support all the thrusters. Although the generator isn't running on full power. The problem here is overheating. The generators are built in a way that they are connecting each other on several axes. We can look into it. You can see here there are several connection points for each generator. And the heat generation is, like everything else in Starbase, unnecessarily complex. So not the generator doesn't just generate heat, so X heat per generator. The generator generates heat based on how many other generators are connected to it. So a generator that is standalone and doesn't have any other generator connecting with itself only needs two radiator panels or one coolant rack in order to generate sufficient cooling. A generator that has other generators on all 6 connection points needs 5 radiators or at least 2 coolant racks. And based on that, the calculation for the radiation plates were wrong, as well as the pipe socket boards. There were not enough pipe socket boards because every pipe socket board has a limit how much radiator cooling rate can be generated, and it was simply not enough. So, the first thing you do is you go and buy a pipe cooling rack from the marketplace, and then place it on one of those generators. I took the upper one because the lower one is blocked by those bolts and some cables there. So you can attach it easily to the top part and then just run a cable through it. That's it, basically. Just connect to an existing pipe wherever you can. That's the first step. So make sure you have another pipe socket port connected to the generators. All the generators are connected with each other, so regardless where you put it, all generators will benefit from it. It's one big generator block, basically. And then you go and buy more radiator panels. So this is, I just show you a picture now. This is how the radiator panels look for you. This is how it looks for me now. So you simply buy 16 more radiator panels and attach them to it. You could do with, I think, 12 as well. But I mean, it just fits, so just do 16, that's fine. They're not too expensive. And then you just attach them all to this. You have to unbolt the one in the back because they're the other way around. Just flip them around, attach them again, and then connect them all. It fits perfectly, no problem here. If you have problems with durability, there's a small trick that you can use right now. Is when you look at... Just get my bolt tool. When you look at those little notches here, you can also simply... There's a sweet spot, see that? There's a sweet spot where you can add an additional bolt. So that helps you to increase the durability, the integrity of those tools, and then you will have no durability issues. Right now, the radiator parts for my ship are not a problem at all. I have a ship warp class of 1.56, and the radiator panels are not even the weakest part, so that's totally fine. And with the extra socket board and the 16 radiator panels, the ship has now enough cooling in order for the radiator to keep running without problems. And then you can run full speed as long as you have fuel rods. The laser will still drain the batteries empty. The generators can simply not generate enough power, but it will give you sufficient enough time before you see problems there. And those are the 3 major bug fixes. The ore collectors, tank and the display, as well as the cooling. And with those 3 things, you already have a good ship. A fine working ship. But there's more you can do. Let's now move over to the minor adjustments that you should do. The first thing is the laser length. You see that the laser beam length and as well the range finder length is set to 8.1 meters. I'm not entirely sure why, and in a chat with the faction member, it seems that it was also just a simple mistake that it didn't take the full 20 meters. So make sure to set it to 20, which is max, so you have the maximum length of your laser, which helps you, of course, mine faster, mine easier, and don't have to go too close to the asteroids in order to mine them properly. Minor adjustments, no problem. A second one that helps you with the with mining an asteroid with your lasers is the turtle mode. You see, this button for me is not slow because it... Wait, what's going on here? I called it slow. The original name is turtle. So the turtle modus would go and simply set the lever binds move speed for each of those levers. It switches between 1 and 0.5. So if turtle modus is activated, it would simply reduce the lever speed to 0.5, which still causes you to thrust out erratically, and it wasn't working for me properly. I still couldn't feel the slower version. Plus, if you would reduce it further by changing the value on the button, you would then see it would start, it would feel like it's lagging because it would not generate enough power first and then suddenly the ship starts spinning around again. And since you are controlling the mining laser, the mining center, with your fingers. So let's see here, if I just use this one and I just tap the, if I just tap the button right now, you see it will sometimes just be too quick, so you can't really control it. With the slow button, for me now, I can actually, I can fine tune it. So I can really fine tune where my laser is showing, which helps of course a lot with mining really efficiently. How did I do that? I left the turtle button untouched. Make sure that when you change it, that the lever speed here is then again 1. Otherwise, you will have permanent turtle speed on your ship, which you don't want to. I, however, went to the flight computer over here, and there you see there is the field called FCU General Multiplier, which is the value of how the thrust is calculated through the thrusters. So in here, I renamed this field slow, so whenever I press the button, it changes between 100 and 50. Also halving it again, but now instead of halving the input to the thrusters, I'm halving the output that the thrusters get. And that helps off with the fine-tuning a little bit. If you reduce it further than 40, you will get the same problem with the leg-like feeling, because it takes a while for the thrusters to generate enough power in order to get where you want to. And if it's below 50, you notice that when you tap the button shortly, it will not actually accept the input. With 50, you have the sweet spot where you can shortly tap the button and you will smoothly, slowly move to the side. So I found this one the most helpful tool. So I renamed the turtle button to slow, and then change the button state values to 100 when off and 50 when on. So, and with that, I can simply now change the slow value and also change the FCU general multiplier. This helps me steering the ship while shooting the laser. Another thing I did is the laser button. I really hate when I have to turn on the laser and then I have lots of lost time where the laser is just burning without hitting anything. So what I did is I changed the button style to 0, which means the laser button is now no longer staying active. It only is active as long as I press the button or as I hit the shortcut that I have set for the laser. In my case, it's space. I simply bound the laser button to space in the ship and then that's it. So whenever I press space, the laser is on. If I let space loose, then the laser is off and that's it. I really love that, and it saves you a lot of power and battery, because again, the battery will drain really fast with the laser on active, even if the generator is running full power. Okay, what else do we have? Oh yeah. Also, one thing I noticed is that when you start, let's say you want to start speeding up your ship, it takes a long time for the FCU forward to actually reach max, which is because they had set the lever bind move speed here to a very low value. I would highly recommend to, at least for the FCU forward and possibly also for the FCU backward, to set a higher move speed that feels good for you. So 4 was the right part for me. You might want to go for 8 or even higher, or you say, no, actually, I like the slow start, that's fine by me, then that's fine by you. But I personally found the 4 a good value. I changed it only for FCU. Oh, no, actually, I increased the backward to 10. Because usually you hit the brakes when you really need to hit the brakes. So you want to have the full brake power as soon as possible. So therefore, I put this one on 10. My mistake. I didn't change all the pitch and roll and jaw and everything. I left it all on 1. Because I actually found this was fine. It felt right, so... But again, if it's too slow or too fast for you, you can change it manually. That's entirely your choice. Another adjustment that I would recommend, is which I haven't done yet myself, is just attach another button or rename another button that you don't use to an identity button. You really want to turn on or off the transponder with a button click. Right now, I'm just doing it here. Actually, my transponder is mostly off, so it doesn't make a difference. But you might want to implement that. It's just a small change, so I would recommend that if you need it. And those are the small adjustments. The laser length, the slow mode, the lever speed for forward and backward, the laser button, as well as the identity button. With those small changes now, you already have a really good shop. You can easily navigate and mine and fly around, and it should work really smoothly, and it should already increase the output of your ship and the handling of ship, so you should already be faster. There is, however, more you can do to optimize your ship. And that's now to the major adjustments, which means we have to kind of modify the scripts that are in the ship. The first thing I want to do is the generator power. The ship comes with this lever, which is called G, which you can move manually in order to set the power minimum for the generators. I personally found that not really helpful. Actually, I had no use for this button at all. Plus, the generator was also overheating, so I didn't get it to test it properly. I'm also not a fan of controlling the generators by controlling the generators directly. I personally rather have the generators controlled by the fuel input. So I decide how much fuel goes in there. Luckily for us, the ship already comes with an option to adjust the fuel rate input. Every field in the fuel chambers, the fuel chamber unit rate limit, so the maximum amount of fuel that is allowed to go through the fuel into the generator, and therefore then controlling how fast the generator is. Here we see the power, right? So the generator unit rate is constant on 100, I don't care. And the power rate is right now on 3.6. Depending on how much fuel is getting through it. Right now it has to charge the battery because there's still a bit left. Yeah, it's still charging the battery very slowly. Or it did, now it's off, and the generators are now standing still. And you can use the shutdown value to control all the fuel chambers in the ship. What I did so in this case was very simple. At first, there is an option to turn off the auto power. So you can turn off the auto power and then control the power generation directly. I haven't changed that one. That one is fine by me. You have the shutdown button, which allows you to completely shut down the ship. It was also called shutdown because it would directly change the fuel input between 0 and 100. Since we are now controlling the fuel input manually, we have to rename the button to shutdown T, so the shutdown taster or button. So we just decided this is the value that controls the shutdown. And also we named this lever from G to shutdown. So this lever now directly controls the fuel input value, as well as here, the shutdown panel shows us exactly. Oh wait, actually, can we go and go to 820 is max. That was a mistake from earlier. So this one now shows us the fuel rate that is generated or that is used by the generators. Okay, so again, auto power, don't change it. Shutdown, rename it slightly differently so it doesn't directly control the shutdown. Rename the button, the lever to shutdown so it controls the fuel. And also rename this panel or set the max value for this panel on shutdown to 28, because that is the max fuel input that we need, because we have so many fuel chambers compared to the generators that the fuel chambers don't need to run on 100%. They only need to run at 28%, and if they leave through 28% of fuel, then all generators can run on 100% power. That's it. Once you have done that, you have to grab the one of those YOLO codes. I'm not entirely sure which one it is because it always changes, but I think the blue one is the one that we're looking for. No, it's actually not. You haven't seen anything, this is for later. So the blue one controls the laser, and the this one controls the power generation. So, you will see that your script looks entirely different. I will post my script in the description of this video so you can copy it and then put it in there line by line. Simply what it does is it checks if shutdown is activated. If the button is pressed, that means every fuel chamber will be set to zero and that's it. There will be no power running through, as it should be. Then it controls if the auto power is active. If the auto power is not active, it means we deactivated the automatic or the automatic generator adjustment, and instead we can adjust the lever directly by ourselves. So nothing to do here. In all other cases, it will simply calculate how much is left within the batteries. So we take 10,000 is one battery, and we remove the battery and divide it by 200 to get a value. The value you use here is depending on at what point do you want the generator to run at max power. I want the generators to run at max power when the batteries are half full. So based on, since we have to reach 28 for full power, this is the value I came up with. So with this line, the generator will be running on full power as soon as the battery is half empty. Then it simply checks the upper and the lower bound. So if the value is below 1, it sets it directly to 0. So you don't have to fight with 0.3, 0.2, 0.1, whatever. If it's below 1, it will set it to 0 and that's it. I mean, at that point, it doesn't really matter. Also the same with the upper bounds. If it's at 27, over 27, then it sets it to 28, the maximum, and that's it. And in any other case, if it's between 1 and 27, it sets the value directly into shutdown, so, and controlling the fuel input. And that's the power script that we have. Simple as that. And with that one now, the generator will run depending on how much power is left. Auto power is on, shutdown is off. So we're just gonna fire the laser a bit in order to generate some power or lose some power. And you see now my shutdown off goes up, my power generation goes up. We are at 12, 18 and 65. Battery is half full and now the generator runs on full power while the shutdown is on 28. So the fuel input is at 28 and the power is at 100. That's it. And that's the whole script. And now the battery will refill themselves. And as soon as the battery reaches the half point again, you will see that the fuel input will go down slowly. There we go, 25. And therefore also the generated power of the generators. It's just a simple script to save unnecessary fuel usage. That's one script. You don't actually need it because there is a script already in there. So feel free to ignore this part. But I personally find that one better, more intuitive, and also I rather control the fuel input than the generators, but that is personal taste. The second script that I have, and the second adjustment, might be of more interest for you. First of all, I don't like the headlamps. It doesn't do much for me, so I renamed the button of the headlamps to manual TP, manual tower pitch. This button will now can be activated in order to manually change the twitch of the pitch of the tower. So let's say I activate it with, I think I have it on 1, yeah. I can now use my lever to manually decide at what point the lasers will shoot. The one important point for that is simply, and we're going to show it, I'm going to turn it off. So right now we're going to do a little mining without the auto power active. When I also bound the collectors and the slow mode on the same button. So if I press the button for the collector, it will also activate the slow mode. There we go. Simply saying that when I'm collecting ores, I want to have the slow mode active. That's it. So right now I'm mining with the standard mining script. And the problem that I have is here is very simple. For the first part, what I really do not like is that the lasers will go back into the standard position of 90 degrees if the laser doesn't find anything. So it will take a while for the lasers to adjust to the current position. I mean, it is working. It's working fine if you just want to fly around, but usually if you want to hit small parts, it's getting really difficult. What I like to do is, I like to find a spot of the for the laser, activate the manual point, and now I know exactly where my laser is, so I can adjust it a little bit. And now, regardless where I'm aiming at, I know that the laser is exactly at what position. It will not go back and forth, it will stay fixed to that location. Which now allows me to very specifically mine minor parts of the thing, of the asteroid. If I notice that the spot isn't right, I can just manually adjust it a little bit, go back and forth, so I make sure to hit everything that I need to. That's what I did here. Okay, so how do I do that? Fairly simple. I added another lever, which looks at the tower pitch. So it will set the tower pitch the same way as it, as the, it will set the same tower pitch as before. It simply displays what the tower pitch is. The minimum is, would be minus 45, and the center output would be 0. Lever bind speed is how much, when I use my buttons, how fast it runs. 0.25 was sufficient for me here. Again, personal taste. So the important part is minus 45 and 0. That's the range of which you want the laser to move. Now, in order to reach that part, in order to allow the system to disable the automatic finding, I had to modify the laser script a little bit. And again, I will post this script now in the description of the video as well. Basically, what I did was I took this script, the first line, put it on the bottom, and then said also, if the manual button is active, then stay on this line. It repeats this line over and over and over, unless the button for manual turret pitch is disabled. There was some more here which I deleted, which wasn't necessary, but the calculation of how to adjust the turret pitch, I haven't changed that formula. This is the original formula from the ship developer, and that's basically it. Those two lines in here, and then suddenly I can fix the turret pitch, which now allows me to more easily mine asteroids. Let's go for this one. Collector is still on. We can disable it for the moment. Also, again, you see my FC forward is way more responsive because I increased the lever speed, and also my braking is way more aggressive. So when I hit the brake, I really hit the brakes. So that was really important, especially if you are flying outside of the safe zone. That's not always a good thing. So make sure to get your brakes in order. So now I'm increasing slowly, advancing slowly to the asteroid. I can see I'm at a length of 10 meters right now, 9. And I disable the automated, the calculation of the laser range. Activate my collector, and now I have my laser here, which I know exactly where it is, and I can go through there. I can also, if I like to, just simply adjust the range a little bit. And then just go forth and dismantle asteroids if I see fit. Let's say I want to go back a bit further back because there's more stuff in at the end of the asteroid, because it was a very, very deep one. So I adjusted the range a little bit of the laser. And I can, as you can see, I can dismantle an asteroid very quickly with the new settings, with the lasers. The ship design itself is really great for that. I just helped a bit to get the maximum out of it. Plus, due to the laser not only firing when I hit the button, it helps to really reduce the dead time where the laser just shoots blankly into space. And I think that's it. Oh, okay, there we go. That's it. Asteroid completely dismantled, everything collected, that's it. Collectors go off, manual TP goes on, off, and that's it. And again, if you get... it took me about 10 minutes with the new settings to get used to the whole ship, and you can fine-tune it to your liking. But you can see how quickly you can now dismantle asteroids with this ship, and it has the speed, it has the crates, it has the design, and now it has all the minor and max and major adjustments and bug fixes in order to become or to be one of the best ships that I can find. If you do it well, the ship itself, it is quite expensive. 55 million is quite a bit of money, but you will get the money back even by safe zone mining. I would say within 2 to 3 hours at max, and then you have gained the money back even if you just sell your ores to the NPC. I thank the developers for this design. It is for the ship developers for this design, because I really love it. I really, really enjoy flying with this ship and mining with the ship, and I don't think I will ever buy another mining ship ever again. Because this one does everything I need, and now in the way that I need it as well. I personally hope that this video has helped you to get the max out of the ship for yourself. Because it would be a shame to not use this ship to its full potential. If you have more questions, feel free to drop them in the comments. Or poke me on Discord if you like. I'm in the Starbase Discord. And I will try to answer them as much as I can. If I'm streaming Starbase, feel free to drop by there and ask questions. My streams and my other videos are in German, but I will reply in English if you have questions and help you out if I can. Because the community helped me a lot as well, so this is my way of trying to give back a little bit. I hope you enjoyed this video, and I hope this ship is giving you as much fun as it did to me, and have a nice day. Bye-bye.